Agitation and Propaganda 101. A lot of times we ask ourselves, what is agitation? It could be events, phrases, actions that urge or promote people to do something about it. It can be a social issue or problem in the community. The something and do something about it depends on what the issue is, what type of response is needed to bring about change. A lot of times when we hear the word agitation, we know that basically it means to stir something up, to start something. And in our communities, we're faced with a variety of issues that need to be addressed. What is propaganda? Forms of communication that is aimed at influence the attitude of the community towards causes or position. Pictures or pieces of information to promote or publicize a particular issue, cause, or point of view. If you control a person's mind, you do not have to tell them how to behave or what to think. They will automatically think and behave how you want them to. The great Marcus Garvey said that this country, the U.S., is so organized that it has propaganda that'll do more damage to a person's mindset than open warfare will. Here are some pieces of propaganda. These are our negative, blatant ones. And this one here is from the Hitler era. As you can see, these all are a way of bringing you to think a certain way. A lot of them are offensive, depending on who it is. There's some people who would totally agree with some of these pictures here. Propaganda can also be something simple like a flyer that explains an event or an issue in the community. How do the two connect? We all have to be able to use everything that we have possible in order to bring awareness, growth, and action to the things that we're trying to change in our communities. Propaganda has to be the voice that anybody can pick up and read. When there's nobody around, your propaganda has to be able to let people know at least a little bit, at least get that spark going as to what you want to happen or what you want to change. And of course, mainstream media cannot be trusted in reporting any of these things. The mainstream media is the biggest propaganda tool that the government has. Any government, they're always going to use their mainstream media. That's why in some countries you have censorship or blockage on news media. And here, we have proof that Dallas PD uses the media. You guys may recognize this officer, he usually comes around to events with his camera, and he also works for WFAA. Here is a picture of his badge. Now, you can't see it very clearly, but it says media, and on the top, it says Dallas County Sheriff's Office. Here is at one of the events at DPD. Dallas police officer taking pictures of protesters that were there, and there she is reviewing them. You can find all these pictures and many more like them on CopWatch. In the media, you have cases like Tobias Mackey. They said that he was banned from Cedar Gardens apartments for selling drugs. The facts on the case were he was unarmed. He was visiting his mother. He was shot 9 times by Officer Matthew Tate. You have James Harper. He is one of the recent cases. Police Chief Brown did a press conference that lasted about an hour, and in it he said he had a wad of money in his pocket and a lengthy criminal record. He was a drug dealer, basically. The media also says that he was not shot in the back. We know that he was unarmed. He was running away from the police, and one of the things that the examiner's report says is that the direction of the bullet was from back to front, downward, and left to right, meaning that he was shot in the elbow from the back. So, from reading the examiner's report, I would guess that he was shot in the elbow, he was running away, turned around, and was shot in the stomach and in the hand. But yet they say he wasn't shot in the back. Robert Husband. Police reported that he could smell marijuana. The gun that they found on him was stolen from the Plano PD. His official report said that he struggled with him because when he got out of the car, he saw he had a gun in his waist and he told him not to go for it and that Robert Husband reached for it and they struggled. They were on the floor struggling over it when he shot him in the back. And then he says that he took the gun from him and placed it on top of the hood of the car. But if you're struggling with somebody, how can you shoot him in the back? If you're on the floor wrestling somebody down, how is it possible to have shot him in the back unless you got up and shot him in the back? So again, the media is not telling the truth about things. They contradict themselves in the same story, the same news articles. You can Google any news article and see that there are contradictions. We have some frequently asked questions. We're talking about police terrorism today because it's something that affects us in every day. A lot of people get harassed by the police. They may not get shot. They may not get killed. That's when it goes to an extreme. Now, we've talked about some of the murders that have happened here in the last 2 years, but there's many more that don't make the news. As we saw yesterday, there were some family members of people who were killed by the police unarmed, but they never made it to the news. And the only time that they really do is when the community is upset about it and there's an uprising. So what really does happen when somebody is murdered by the police? An investigation is supposed to take place. The police have a department called the Internal Affairs. Internal Affairs will only investigate if someone files an authorized complaint to their offices. And again, the Internal Affairs is the police investigating the police. So you know there's going to be a bias there. What person do you know that's going to convict their brother of any crime? Citizens Review Board will meet and discuss the case. That's what Dallas currently has right now. Who is the Citizens Review Board? It's a board that has 16 members that are appointed by the Dallas City Council. Some of the previous members have been retired police officers, retired military. They really have no power. Is it effective? No. They are not allowed to investigate, subpoena, or prosecute. They're not even so much as allowed to give a recommendation or their opinion onto what happened. So what is the Citizens Review Board there for? For show? To take up space at City Hall? One time a month? So we have something that we're presenting to the community as Office of the Police Monitor. What is Office of the Police Monitor? At this point, it's a group of organizations and individuals that are trying to get this office on the ballot. What it stands to do is to completely replace the Citizens Review Board. One of our goals is to end police terrorism. We know that that's not going to happen overnight, and that the Office of the Police Monitor is not going to ensure that it'll stop police terrorism. But at least if we can start holding them accountable for the things that they do, the murders, the harassments, and stop the impunity that current officers have a right to, it seems like, because they're in arms or they're in badge. We've had cases in Arlington with, what was his name?
Tay Reynolds.
He was an 18-year-old boy who was killed by an off-duty police officer from Houston, nowhere near his jurisdiction. This man who shot him had at least 10 years worth of complaints from his community, from the beat that he terrorizes. And he's never been disciplined for it, and he was still an officer. What happened with that situation was there was a fight at a park. And the kids, once the fight finished, they went down the street. One of the girls, it was a girl fight that was done after the fight, was driving her car. She must have been emotional because she was driving erratically. She crashed into somebody's car. This officer was visiting his brother. He lives in Arlington, and again, he's an off-duty police officer from Houston, Texas. He came out and was like, what's going on? He wanted to fight the kids, and Tay, being an 18-year-old man, said, you know what, this has nothing to do with you. Go back inside. So what does this officer do? He drives back to his hotel room, goes to get his gun, comes back and shoots him. He hunted him down like a dog. He chased him. He shot him several times in the front and in the back. At one point, a nurse who's a neighbor of his brother came out trying to help to see, you know, what was going on. All she sees is a boy laying on the floor shot. And he told her to go back in her house or he would shoot her too. No type of conviction. That's what all these cases have. There's no conviction. There was one conviction back in the 70s when there was two boys and Santos Rodriguez, an 11-year-old boy, was killed. Two Dallas police officers picked him and his 13-year-old brother for supposedly vandalizing a vending machine. Now, the reports that they put out, the descriptions match nothing of these two boys. They were in the streets. They were just walking home. They took him into the police car, put Santos in the front, put his brother in the back, and they played Russian roulette with him. They shot him in the head. They killed him in front of his 13-year-old brother. One officer was indicted, but I don't think he served very long. Dallas downtown witnessed a riot of black and brown communities, and they're upset. They were tired of it. This was in the civil rights era. They were tired of the harassment that they were going through, and it was blatant what they had done to some children. Now, they claimed that there was supposed to be a riot in Dixon Circle over James Harper shooting. But it was really a military state. There was over 300 cops there in full riot gear, ready to level that community. Luckily, that didn't happen. Because in our experience, we spoke to the community members, and as those community members said, why would I destroy my own neighborhood? Why would I burn down my house? So how is the OPM different from the Citizens Review Board, somebody might ask? It's for the people who are currently on the review board and Dallas Police, it is very radical. The head of the Dallas Police Association has said, if Dallas citizens want me to stop chasing criminals, then I will do that. In a very sarcastic way. We're not telling him to stop chasing criminals or stop fighting crime. We're telling them, don't kill them. You're not the judge, you're not the jury, and you damn well ain't the executioner. That's what we're asking for. So please ask that nobody get these things confused. But the main thing that will be different is that the board members will be democratically elected in a popular vote and not appointed by the city council. They would be able to initiate investigations without a written complaint from anybody. If they hear of something, a shooting, a beating, they can go out and investigate on a drop of a dime, not based off waiting for somebody to come and complain, because we all know that these communities of people who are affected by this are terrorized, and victims of terror are going to be traumatized to not speak against their oppressor. They don't want any repercussions, especially after someone of their own has been shot down and killed by the police. They'd be able to investigate independently from the police departments, and they'd also have subpoena and prosecutorial power. These cops don't have to answer to anybody but their police chief or their commanding officer when something like this happens. We don't think that's right. If any of us went and killed a police officer, we'd be hanged probably that night. If not in a public spectacle, for sure we'd be beaten and lose there while in custody. We wouldn't be able to just walk around freely. In the case of Oscar Grant, you had Officer Meserly, who was being indicted for the murder of Oscar Grant. Now this is on video, a man unarmed, handcuffed, sitting on the floor, shot while this officer stood over him and shot him. And they still didn't want to indict him. What did this officer do? He fled from the Bay, California, to Las Vegas, hiding from the trial. If we would do that, we would go to jail right away. Our bail, we wouldn't have any type of bail. because you'd be fleeing from that. So what we're asking is for, in situations like these, where people are unarmed and excessive force is used, is that they no longer get the opportunity to walk around freely. It's not fair to anybody. It's not fair for the families. It's not fair for our communities to see how an officer can get away with murder. They are, after all, humans as well. They should be treated like civilians when they kill somebody who's unarmed. We're not here to defend anybody who was in the action of a crime. For example, there's a hostage situation. You know, that's the choice that somebody made. But when it's something like getting pulled over for not signaling, you should not be killed for that. At this time, anybody have any questions?
So, have there been any response from the city of Dallas? I mean, has this organization presented any documents or any official requests, and has there been a response?
We have requested information from the city of Dallas, the police department, as far as statistics of how many people have died in custody, how many shootings that officers are involved with. Thus, they have chosen to charge us upwards of $2,000 for this information. When it's supposed to be public information, it should be free access. But so at this point, we just have what comes out in the news media. We don't have solid numbers. Because they won't give those to us, which again, public information should be free of charge for anybody who requests it. But we believe that it's a method of getting us from not getting that information to present it to the community, to the public.
Are there other cities that have a review board? That's not a review board. That have organizations like you're talking
about? Citizen-based organizations.
There are some. I believe there's one in San Francisco. There's different, I guess you could say, factions of this. None of them are alike. None of them are exactly the same. But for something like this to pass, where it'd be completely up to the community, that it would be elected by the people in the city, and for them to have to answer back to the people is a very radical idea. A lot of people in different cities they think that that's not possible because they haven't really seen it happen. I'm not sure exactly how the San Francisco board works, but I do believe it's similar as far as they are able to investigate and prosecute officers.
How long is the term of a member of your
I'm not sure exactly. It's in the ordinance. The ordinance can be found on dallasforchange.org or dallasforchange.com. In order to get this ordinance passed in the city of Dallas, there has to be 20,000 signatures from city of Dallas registered voters in order to put it on a ballot. That or the city council can vote on it and say, yes, go ahead and put it on the ballot. And we know that's not going to happen. Because that's one less power that they get to do, one less anointment, one less office that they get to choose for, one less promise of, let me put you on this board and you give me the campaign money or whatever it is that they want. So they're not going to just vote on it. We know that. They've tried it in the past, I think in 1987, and it didn't work. That's when they also did the current Citizens Review Board. But a lot of things were compromised on it. And a lot of things were not implemented on it. And you can also find an article detailing that on dallasforchange.org. We have 180 days to get these signatures, to get them on the ballot for the May 2013 elections.
Yeah, they do elections in this city off of November. Mm-hmm. So I guess the step you're looking for now is getting signatures.
Getting the signatures together. And one of the things why we're doing this today is to also bring awareness to it. A lot of people aren't aware that there's actually something they can do. Some people will say, well, we already have a citizen's review board. People don't know the details that go, what they actually can and can't do. So, I mean, we feel like all the murders have been too many, and we don't want any more to go in vain. This, again, may not stop the police from killing anybody, but at least if they know that they'll be prosecuted, that they will be serving some time, they'll think twice before they go and get trigger happy in our communities.
I guess that's what you call democracy.
Well, we really appreciate what you're doing, and we're like the videographers for North Texas, and we're happy to put a record out there. I'll post this video to the Organizing for Change page.
Okay.
And the rest will be available to you as well. So.
Okay.
Could you tell us your name and how you got involved?
My name is Cassandra Guerra. I am with the Dallas Brown Beret. We're one of the organizations in the Coalition for DallasToChange.org. And growing up, I've always seen the negative side of police officers when dealing with my family, with my father specifically. So I know exactly where this is coming from. It's not anything I read on the papers or that I saw on TV. These are things that I've actually lived. And my goal is to better the communities that I live in, the communities that I serve. That and I also believe in equal rights for everybody. Everyone has the right to leave freely and peacefully, happily.
Well, we're going to appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, you guys, this is the live video for Organizing for Change Facebook page. And so we'll be back with more video as this progresses as we move towards the election.
Okay, I'm the secondary feed. I'll feed to him, and he'll edit if need be. But
okay.
His bloggy feed's the main feed.
Okay.
Okay.
So what we'll go over now is we do intend to file. Okay.